tonight, we've spent the last couple of months looking at schemes of the devil. Tonight is not specifically a study in that series. We're gonna branch off for a couple of weeks, and yet it's actually part of the schemes of the enemy. And the title of this is Circumcision of the Flesh, and that may seem a little bit strange to you. What could we possibly be studying about here? But actually, what we're going to do is, it's much like many of the messages that God gave to the descendants of Israel were physical things that they did that were illustrative of a spiritual, a deeper, a higher spiritual reality. And this whole thing about circumcision is likewise the same way. Now, we all know what physical circumcision is. And according to the Jewish custom, on the eighth day, the foreskin of the males are removed. And by the way, you'd be interested to know that research recently from Purdue University found that on the eighth day is when the platelets can begin to clot. Isn't that interesting? In human blood, 110%. How about that? Isn't that something? And that's on the eighth day. So God's instruction, he's the designer, he's the one who built it, so he kind of knows a few things about that. But that's a little aside. We know what physical circumcision is. The question is, what is the spiritual message behind circumcision? And see, God has always been in the business about the heart. And one of the scriptures I have for you here in Jeremiah, God comes right out and says, the whole house of Israel are uncircumcised of heart. You see, they weren't getting the spiritual message. All of the ceremonies that God gave in fact, let's go take a look. It's not on your scripture list. We'll start off with one that's not even there. Let's go to Isaiah. We have looked at this previously, but let's go look at this verse in Isaiah, and maybe this might broaden our understanding a little bit. Isaiah 28th chapter. Now, we've looked at this before, but I want you to consider this, take this to heart, and look at this in view of what it is that God really wants. What is it that God really wants from us? You know, if you looked around, if you were a person who had no religious background at all, and you were to look around and ask the question, according to Christian groups in America, what business is God really in? And I think some could rationally conclude that God is in the building business, because you need to build these holy places so that there are places for God to hang out and we go see God there, or we go meet God there. It's been a while, Katie, since I brought up about stained glass, but there's another good one there. You know, some people would say God's in the stained glass business. Because, you're going to preserve all these historical events and everything in the form of stained glass, and stained glass is beautiful and all. But is God in the stained glass business? Some people would conclude that God is in the carpet and pew business. Some would conclude that God's in the music business. Some would conclude God's in the fundraising business. You listen to Christian radio, you have a 30-minute program, and you get about 18 minutes of how, if you don't send some money in, send your gift of $100 or more, and I'll send you a video, I'll send you a cloth that I've prayed over, whatever, because if you don't send us your $100 or more, then we won't be on radio next week to come back and ask you to send more money in so we can come on back on the next week. So I can see if people were just looking rationally at what's going on around, there are a lot of different things that people would say, God's in this business or that business. So what is it that God really wants? Does He want us to build buildings and put up stained glass and have radio and TV ministries and go on missionary journeys and all that? You know what? God can be at work in any of those things, but what is God primarily interested in, and what is it He's looking for? Listen to this from Isaiah 28. To whom would He teach knowledge? That's verse 9. Sorry about that. Thank you. Isaiah 28:9. To whom would he teach knowledge, and to whom would he interpret the message? Why does the message need interpretation? Because Jesus told us it is not granted for a person to understand the Scripture who has not turned their heart to God. So this last week, when I was spent an hour and a half on the phone with an atheist guy, talking to him about Scripture and his complaints about the things that God didn't include in the Ten Commandments, and I said, why does that bother you, since you don't believe there's a God anyway? Well, it bothers me. You know, he should have had this in there, and he should have had that in there. You know, it's amazing how we Americans, you know, we're so full of ourselves that we really think we should be advising God and explaining to him and what he should have done 6,000 years ago, as though we understand what life was like for people 6,000 years ago. But anyway, be that as it may, there has to be understanding granted of the Scripture. And Jesus, remember, in the parable of the sower that we started out with a couple of years ago, and we've looked at it again, and we will go back again, because we need to understand and comprehend what Jesus said in Matthew 13, Mark 4, Luke 8. He said it. The disciples were amazed that Jesus taught in parables. And they actually asked him, why do you teach in parables? Nobody's understanding this. And Jesus said, it's because to them it is not granted to understand the mysteries of God. We have to remember, you cannot intellectually figure this thing out. It is spiritually discerned and understood as the Holy Spirit becomes your teacher as you turn to the Lord. So to whom would he teach knowledge? Verse 9. And interpret the message. Those just wait for the milk. Those just take it for the breast. The immature ones, the young ones. He says, order on order, order on order, line on line, line on line, a little here, a little there. Indeed, now, he says in verse 11, he will speak to this people through stammering lips and a foreign tongue. He who said to them, here's what God's message to his people has always been. Here is rest. Give rest to the weary. Here is repose. But they would not listen. See, what God has always said was, come to me. Jesus put it this way, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Rest from what? Oh, we don't have to work anymore, because Jesus is going to take a little sack lunch and feed us all the time. Free meals for everybody. Jesus isn't in the business of bypassing the need for you to work to provide for your needs and the needs of your family. Now, and when they were in the wilderness, because they couldn't raise crops, and because they couldn't sew fabrics and make clothing for the 40 years they were in the wilderness, God fed them, and their shoes didn't wear out and their clothes didn't wear out. But it's interesting, the Bible does record when they crossed the Jordan River into the Promised Land, then their clothes and shoes start wearing out again. Isn't that interesting? See, because God knows the human heart. And man always likes to take the path of least resistance. And our American government is beginning to figure out that if you will give people food for nothing, they'll stay home and take it. And then they'll demand better and more from you who do go in labor. The human being is naturally lazy. And that's why the Bible says if anyone is not willing to work, there are times that people are hurt and injured and people need some help. But if anyone is not willing to work, then neither let him eat. So God understands these things about the human heart. And when he comes to this, God is offering to people peace and rest. Rest from what? Rest from the battle of this world. Because there is an enemy who's fighting against us, who wants to destroy us. And we've been looking for weeks at the many different ways in which he schemes with a plan of destruction for your life. And everybody in this room bears in your soul and in your mind, and some of you physically in your body, the scars of the enemy's scheme to destroy your life. But God's saying to your soul and to your spirit, come to me, I'll give you rest. You can enter into and have a Sabbath's rest with me. But you have to come to me with all your heart. And you have to love me with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And then I'm going to give you some guidelines so you know how you should interact with your fellow man out there. But notice, God's people were not willing. They would not listen. So Isaiah says, the word of the Lord to them will be, verse 13, order on order, order on order, line on line. I think it's King James that says line on line, precept on precept. A little here, a little there. Listen, that they may go and stumble backward, be broken, snared, and taken captive. Now all of this is about the Word of God coming to us. How are the people who won't come to God the way He wants, how are they being snared? They're being snared because the Word of God becomes a bunch of laws and rules and regulations for them. That's where they're snared. And it's very clearly illustrated for us in what they did with Jesus. When Jesus came, they watched closely everything He would do because they knew all the rules and regulations and they wanted to zap Him if He got out of line. And also to say, you can't be from God because you healed a sick person on the Sabbath day. You see, because God's Word to them had become a bunch of rules and regulations. The relationship that God has always wanted with His people is a dynamic, living, active interrelationship with Him. You see, almost every church out there today makes up their own set of rules and regulations because they miss it. A walk with God is not about following a bunch of rules. A walk with God is loving a living, active, dynamic personality who created all of this, that has phenomenal capability to keep track of information. I have to say it again because it just blows my mind. So I didn't learn this in science in Christian college. They didn't know this back then, back a long time ago, 45 years ago, when my wife and I were in college. But you take one teaspoon. We have a spoon over here. Are you spoons over here tonight? We only have a big one? All right. This is not a teaspoon. This is big enough that if Kurt got sleepy, I could go wake you up. This is not a teaspoon. This holds probably about 8 teaspoons, maybe, something like that. If this was a teaspoon, if you took the DNA from one cell and filled up, not this, 1/8 of this, a teaspoon, there's enough information that God put in the DNA that would fill 1 teaspoon, that it would have all the information needed to build 600 million plants and animals. Instructions would fit in 1/8 the size of this. 600 to 900 million plants and animals on this earth. And there'd be enough room left over that you could also write down all the recorded books ever written in human history on top of that. That's what God did inside the DNA of one living cell. I think we need to be kind of giving God a little advice on how to do things, and where He's messed up. But you see, God is a living personality, and He put His traits in every one of us. The good things you see in human beings, those are characteristics and qualities that God had. One of the things that really has bothered those who believe in Darwinian macro evolution, in this concept of the survival of the fittest, it absolutely makes no sense, the compassion that human beings and the empathy human beings have for others. That doesn't make any sense at all. Where does that come from? It's completely irrational if you're an evolutionist. It makes no sense. Because it should be crushed those that can be crushed. Because it's survival of the fittest. The other thing that makes no sense at all is, according to Darwinian theory, the order for things like life came out of chaos. How many things do you see out in the world around you where chaos changes magically into order? You know what? I've not one time had a yard, if I leave it alone, it would just naturally get better. My kids' behavior, if I left them alone, the longer I was away from them, the worse it got. But I'm supposed to believe that out of this chaos, bloop, all of a sudden this life came. Yes, ma'am? Our conscience being gone?
Yes.
Well, you know, the Bible does say that some people so harden their hearts that their conscience is seared like with a branding iron. They no longer have a conscience. When you look at some of the things that human beings have done to each other, with all the technological advances and all the comforts of life over the last 120 years, there's more blood been shed in the last 100 years and probably in the previous 1,000. And by the way, the majority of it, you know who shed the blood of the people? Their own governments did that. Their own governments killed them. But you guys, one politician recently put it, clinging to your Bible and to your guns, you're afraid of our government. How silly. Yeah, how silly? Well, that's the Chinese. They don't even know for sure how many were slaughtered in China in the revolution 100 years ago, a little less than 100 years ago. But it's at least 120 million. It might be as many as 200 million people killed by their own government. Joseph Stalin, who, by the way, had memorized the four Gospels, murdered something like 20 million of his own people. A bunch of them, they starved to death. They went out and took all of their crops from them. The Ukrainian people were hit the hardest. But you see, when you look at that, you think, how can people be that hard-hearted? Because that conscience that God puts in people can be seared. Because people's hearts become hardened and they're motivated and absorbed by so many different things. So the question comes back here. God says, here's what I wanted. I want to give you rest. Here's rest for the weary. But they wouldn't listen. They would not take it. And so what did they get? They got a bunch of rules and regulations. What's amazing is, while they would go out and carry out many of the ceremonies and rituals, and the temple ceremonies and the sacrifices, very few of them got the message of what he was really speaking. Because the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer can never forgive sin. It never could. It was an object lesson. It was illustrative of what God was going to do. The whole experience of Passover. You have to understand that little lamb stayed with the family. Became the family pet. And then God says, this precious little lamb has to die on this night. You put its blood on the post and on the lintel. Otherwise, death will come to your family and the oldest in the household will die. That's bizarre. Why would God do something like that? Because God's looking long range. And he was illustrating what he was going to do to make provision for unrighteous mankind to have a way to have a relationship with the holy God. Do you remember when Moses wanted to see God's face and God said, you can't see my face? It would kill you! You would die! But I'll put my hand over you as I pass by and you can see me from behind. And just the impact of him seeing God from behind, his face radiated so much it scared the people when he came back down off the mountain. But even there, do you realize, as unique an experience as Moses had, do you remember what God originally asked? He said, okay, I want all the men of Israel come up on the mountain to meet with me. And there's thunder and lightning and earthquakes. They were sensing the presence and the power of God. And they were a bunch of cowards. And he said, Moses, you go check with God. You wait down here. You go see what he has to say. But God actually intended for all of them to come up on the mountain to Him. But they weren't willing. But you see, God doesn't make anybody be willing. Because with God, you have to make that choice in your own heart. And that's true for any of the benefits that God has for those of us who are living right here in Arizona right now. The kingdom of God. God is delighted to give us the kingdom and the benefits of it. And we've been learning about some of those as we pray for sick people. And we see sick people getting well. And we pray for people that are in bondage to the powers of darkness and ungodliness. And they repent that God gives them a new start. How can that happen? It's the power of God's kingdom, the power of His Spirit. But when you're not willing to come the way God wants you to, then you get a bunch of rules and regulations. And that's sort of some background as we think about this thing of the circumcision of the flesh. Because this, in my estimation, is one of the greatest schemes that Satan has going. Because of what it does to people's hearts. And by the way, when they go and they stumble backwards and they're taken captive, what are they taken captive by? They're taken captive by their own religious rules and regulations. It makes them feel holy and righteous. And they begin to look down their noses at other people because we're the holy and righteous ones and you're the unholy ones. You see, that was the mistake that the whole nation of Israel made. It was never intended that the descendants of Israel become this exclusive club that are better than all the scum, the dregs of the earth. God wanted them to illustrate the benefits and the blessings of having a relationship with a holy and righteous and living God and an all-powerful God so that the rest of the world would be drawn to Him. But instead, they spurned them, and they hated everybody else, and they despised them as they stood in their self-righteousness. That's the very affliction that struck the prophet Jonah. God says, I want you to go to Nineveh. Oh, they hated the Ninevites. Wicked, evil, ungodly city. And He says, Jonah, I want you to go preach. Tell them to repent or I'm going to destroy their city. And of course, you remember Jonah. He had plans. You know, I got a ticket down to Haifa. I'm going to get on a Mediterranean cruise ship and go out across the Mediterranean. And of course, the storm comes, and everybody's in a panic, and they're all crying out to their gods, and Jonah's laying back in the boat, asleep. They came. I have a feeling they probably kicked you pretty hard. Hey, go! What are you doing sleeping? We're about to perish. Oh, he said, and he looked up at him and said, oh, this storm, it's because of me. What? You know what's going on? We're throwing cargo overboard. We don't think we're going to live. And you're saying this is because of you. He said, yeah, throw me overboard and it'll be fine. And they went, no. If your God is powerful enough to bring a storm like this on because He's telling you to do something you're not willing to do, then we don't think we're going to throw you overboard. And finally, they were so desperate. They prayed and said, Jonah's God, whoever you are, please don't hold His blood on our heads. But, you know, okay, we're going to do what He says. And as soon as they threw Him overboard, then he was calm. The whole problem was that Jonah despised the people of Nineveh. Why? Because his whole life he'd been taught all these rules and regulations, and if you don't do this, you're wicked, filthy, dirty, ungodly, and of no use to God, and so he despised them. Well, that's right. He goes and he preaches. And the whole city repents. And they said it was a 2 days walk around, which they estimate that to be, you know, 1.5 to 2 million people in population. And the whole city repents. The city fathers right down to the garbage collectors. And then he's mad. I knew you would do this, God. That's why they want to come here to preach. I want to see the fireworks. These wicked, ungodly Ninevites. Blow them up. And I want you to know there are people in Christian churches in America today that have exactly the same attitude about America and American cities. And it's evil. And it comes because of fleshly circumcision. You see, the righteousness that we have is given to us by the Holy Spirit. It's not that we're better than other people. It's because God's grace has manifested itself greater in us. Jesus said, I didn't come into the world to judge the world. I came to save it. So he didn't go around shaking his finger in everybody's face. This fellow I was talking to the other night, he says, well, you know, what's your opinion about the people that do this? And I'm like, I have no opinion about people's conduct. I'm here to share what the Word of God says. Wherever people are, God is calling them out of that place into a relationship with the living God. And he, once he takes hold of their heart, he'll fix everything that needs to be fixed on the outside. And it's not my business to tell them. They've got to do X or Y. It's not. Get over ourselves. Because we have been captivated by this very thing that I'm hoping you can begin to see tonight. And I don't expect you to just fully grasp what I'm trying to share about this tonight. But maybe depending on where you come from in your adventures in the study of Scripture, maybe you'll be able to grasp it. This is the thing that probably was a good 12 or 15 years before it finally dawns on me what God's talking about. Let's see if we can get some of this. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 2. What we're going to see in Ephesians is the substance in the way of fruit from our lives. The substance of what God is concerned about and what God's addressing. You see, religious groups today, in some places, it's what clothing you wear. It's what language you're speaking. In some cases, it's what translation of the Bible that you're studying from. As if, you know, there's an evil one out there that, you know, you go straight to hell if you read from it. This is still being taught. It's still going on. And there are people still in bondage to this junk. What is the substance in our lives that God wants to address to move us closer in a relationship with Him? He's describing that in Ephesians 2. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, spiritually dead, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. You know who the prince of the power of the air is? That's Satan, the forces of darkness. That's right. Of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. I want you to notice how often when we read spirit, we're thinking attitude. No. This is a spirit that he's talking about here. It's not an attitude. It's a spirit that controls attitude and influences conduct, but it's an unclean spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. That is, the people going the way of the world. And then Paul says, among them too, we all formerly lived in the lusts of our flesh, indulging the desires of the flesh, that's the lust of the eyes, the things the eye focuses on and wants and covets and so forth. And of the mind, there it is, pride. You know that knowledge puffs up? There's always a danger you get to really studying in depth in God's Word, and you start packing your mind with information. The result of that is that you get proud. That's the natural response. Knowledge puffs up. Look what I know. But love edifies. When you're really loving others, you're going to want to say the things and do the things and speak the things that are to build up the other person. So here he is in the lust of the mind. Pride, I'm smarter than you, and so forth. And he says, and we were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead, and that's spiritually dead, speaking, you understand, no spiritual life, we were dead in our transgressions, he made us alive together with Christ. And by his grace, his influence in our heart, you've been saved. And he raised us up with him. Look, he seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That's why we can, what's that?
That's the location of God's Christ. We are there.
And see, with that come benefits like praying for the sick and they get well. and showing the love of Jesus to people that are unlovely. That's the power to turn the other cheek. And if you see your enemy hungry, you feed him. If he's thirsty, you give him something to drink. And if he has a flat tire, you stop and help him. You see, that's that because we are seated in heavenly places in Christ. And so, in verse 7 he says, he's doing this in order that in ages to come he might show the surpassing riches of his grace, his influence in kindness toward us in Christ. For by God's influence, by God's grace, you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God. So you see, the mercy and the grace of God, the influence of God that cause us to change direction and to quit being unforgiving toward those who wronged us, to quit being jealous, to quit looking on other people's property with lust or greed or envy, that we want what they have. All of that is God's influence that transforms this ungodly fleshly nature of ours that we put under our feet, and by His Spirit, then we move into this new life that He's given us. So this is the grace, His influence that saves us, and it's God's gift. And it's not as a result of works, so no one should boast. Say, well, but you have to see, I was circumcised on the eighth day, so I'm holy and pure and righteous. You weren't circumcised on the eighth day, so you're not. Well, physical circumcision can cause that sort of thing. But there are spiritual messages and spiritual ways in which we try to circumcise people around us. See, the thing I kept looking at in the Bible, I kept seeing so much instruction and warning, be careful of those of the circumcision. Well, in the physical sense, Paul was battling with Jewish people who were teaching the Jewish traditions and saying, even to those following Jesus, you have to first become a Jew, follow the Jewish practices, and then you can be saved and be a Christian. I understand that, but you see, this book was written for our instruction upon whom the ends of the ages have come. I don't know if I know more than one person that's a Jew. I mean, personally, why is there so much in this Bible warning me to be on guard about those of the circumcision? And that's when I began to pray and say, God, show me what this means. And over a period of months and probably a couple of years, then I began to see through the Scripture that this is one illustration of a spiritual nature that's going on around us. For example, we were having Bible study when I was working in the transmission business out in Tennessee some years ago. I was a service manager, so people would call in, tell me about their transmission woes, and I would help make the arrangements to get it in. Unfortunately, I never learned how to rebuild transmissions. I'm really looking back now. That would have been a lot more fun, especially dealing with the angry customers. You know, people in their car, you know, it's tough. I'll tell you a few stories about that. But at lunchtime, we're sitting around the table, and this guy comes in who's selling peaches from Georgia. We're in Chattanooga, Tennessee, which, you know, we literally could throw a rock to Georgia from where we lived in Tennessee. It was three houses down in the middle of the street was the state line road. Anyway, this guy comes in with these peaches from Georgia, and, you know, they're like the size of our small grapefruits. Oh my goodness. Take a bite and it just runs all down your chin and everything. Okay. So anyway, this guy steps in to see if we're interested in buying peaches. I'm gonna borrow your cap, by the way. And he's wearing a cap. And he steps inside and he sees we're in Bible study and he goes like this. Oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't realize you're having a service. And we looked at each other and said, let's have a Bible study. Come on in and have a seat. Oh, no, I don't want to interfere with your service. Now, was he being respectful? Well, okay. But let me tell you, there was something more. This action was his fleshly circumcision. You see, The way you reverence God is, if somebody is praying, if somebody's reading the Bible, you take your hat off and you lower your head to show how godly you are and how revered you are in the things of God. Well, it just so happens that we've shared some with this guy before. And he wasn't interested because he already had his circumcision all worked out. And we were going away and trying to have a discussion with him. Hey, we want to share with you some of what we're learning here. And one of the guys kind of got annoyed. It wasn't me. There are other days it would have been me, but it wasn't me. And he says to the guy as he's leaving, all right then, blind yourself and be blind. And the guy goes, thanks, I will. I don't know if that helps you to begin to grasp this thing about fleshly circumcision. But I know that was an eye-opener for me because I realized that to him, his godliest duty is you take your hat off and you bow your head if somebody's reading the scripture, if somebody's praying, or if a service is going on. Is God really offended if somebody's got a hat on or a cap on? It offends some people. You know what I say to that? Get over yourself. All right? Get over yourself. Because while this guy wouldn't dare be in a room where the Bible's being read or prayer being spoken with his cap on, his heart wasn't yielded to God. He wasn't seeking God with all of his heart. He was saying, I won't come to God the way he wants me to with all of my heart, but I'll give him my cap and cover my heart. And that's what I'm going to offer to God instead. That's fleshly circumcision. And those are the kind of people that if you're praying, we were in a softball league with other churches in Mason some years ago. And after it's over, and we've all had our argument and fighting over the game and everything, it was all required that we hold hands and pray. And when we do that, guess what? Everybody would say, oh, take your hats off, we're going to pray. And after a while, we start looking at each other and saying, no, I would love to talk to you about 1 Corinthians 11 about hats and haircuts and shawls. Because it has nothing to do with a ball cap on my head and I'm not taking my hat off, and we would pray to God. And people would get ticked off. Why? Because that was their fleshly circumcision. See how godly I am? I take my hat off. Showing respect. Now, by the way, somebody might do that with pure motive. Well, that's okay. I'm not saying it's wrong to take your hat off, but I want you to know God couldn't care less whether you take your hat off or not. When somebody's reading the Bible, he's interested in your heart. And America has been championing this thing of all kinds of fleshly circumcision. Part of that is, don't you dare read from any translation except the King James Bible. Now, if I started down the list, I probably would hit on one that would bug you. I'm not intentionally trying to do that, but I'm offering to you the opportunity to see something that God wants us to change in our perspective about dealing with Him. It is not even about, a relationship with God is not even about following the message of the Sermon on the Mount. Churches want to make those the new laws. But Jesus was saying a person that has a relationship with Holy God and lives in the kingdom is the kind of person that does this. He blesses those who curse him. He does good to his enemies. He prays for them. That's the kind of person who has connected with the holy and living God. Not because he circumcised his flesh so that he always bows his head when he prays, or closes his eyes, or takes his hat off. Or before he puts food in his mouth, he always stops to pray. Well, wait a minute. The Bible says, nothing's to be refused if it's received. yes. Do you think that that means take your hat off, bow your head, and close your eyes? I know a family that was the absolute law. And while the head of the house made sure that there was always prayer before you ate, he was molesting the girls in the family. But we always, in that family, we always had to pray before we dare to go before we eat something. You see, folks, that's fleshly circumcision. God's not impressed. And so often prayer becomes nothing more than like a zipper. Oh, it's time to open meeting. Got to have prayer. Oh, no, we didn't have prayer. Stop, stop. But the reality is, folks, if we're not in tune with God, as we come to a meeting, stopping for a moment, say, oh, say these words, how much of that is really coming from our hearts? Now, if you want to get annoyed about that, then there's just some good fodder to go get annoyed about. But I'm telling you, it's not about whether you pray a prayer or not before you eat the meal. It's about the attitude in your heart. And the Lord started dealing with Lynn and I about this some years ago. And so we got to where, if we were getting ready to eat, I would look around at my sons and say, you realize that we are blessed that God has provided this for us. Are you thankful? And they got to say, yeah, Dad, I'm thankful. Good, let's eat. We didn't bow our heads. We didn't close our eyes. Not that there's something wrong with that, but folks, that can become nothing more than a ceremony where our hearts are far away from God. You see, that's what the descendants of Israel were doing. And so here in Ephesians, he's starting to address the things that really do matter to God. And the things that matter to God, we're seeing right here. Look at what he's talking about. We're dead in our trespasses and sins. We used to walk like the world does. See, that's what he's leading up to. And then he's talking about how God brings us transformation in our heart, and it's not about now we take our cap off before we pray. And it's not now that we bow our head and close our eyes and give thanks before any food touches your lips. When we were in India some years ago, they actually have a guard at the gate of the meeting to keep all the sick people away from coming in where the pastors were. There were 1,000 pastors in this meeting in Bangalore, India. And so some of us went out to the gate to pray for sick people. And we couldn't understand what they were saying, but they were grabbing our arms saying, come. And so a friend of mine and I, we walked down this nasty canal with this really nasty water in it, back down there a ways, and off, and came into the house, and here's a woman laying sick, been in bed for some period of time. We couldn't understand them enough, and they couldn't understand us enough to know exactly what was going on, but we laid hands on and prayed for her. And when we finished praying, out they came with a couple of cups of drink. Now, we've been really, really careful. We don't want to be presumptuous of the Lord. We drank only bottled water. We were in a place that a million people were Europeans, as they say. White people never came. And you could not buy purified water. They went down and they bought some little glass jars for batteries. And we mostly ate a lot of fruit to get the liquid. And my friend and I, we looked at each other and said, there's nothing to be refused if it's received with thanksgiving. And we thanked them and said, thank you, Lord, for this. If you drank it, it was something like, kind of like a mix of cocoa and coffee or something. And by the way, the lady got healed. She got up out of the bed right there while we were there. And we, you know, they were all rejoicing and we went on our way. I did make sure to check my heart at that time. Lord, I didn't want to offend them. Nothing's to be refused if it's received with thanksgiving. I don't know if it'd been like with my parents in Korea, if they were serving dog, if I would have been able to do that. But anyway, those would be a challenge. See, we've been saved by grace through faith, and it's not of ourselves. It's not of these circumcision things that we do. It's not these outwardly fleshly things we do, but it's a transformation of heart. And it is not a result of works that no one should boast. But I don't want to stop before we read verse 10. Because in some traditional groups, they love Ephesians 2, 8, 9, but they don't want you to read verse 10. Because it grates against their tradition. Listen to verse 10. For we are His, God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, listen, for good works, which he prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Because I've been a preacher of righteousness for some time, I have constantly been accused by people in traditions of teaching salvation by works. There are two kinds of works in the Bible. This is the works of the flesh. These are our righteousnesses that are filthy rags. Don't handle, don't taste, don't touch. But you see, there's another kind of work. These are actions and deeds of obedience to God's guidelines that I'm compelled to walk in because my heart is seeking after God. If I seek after God, my heart compels me to do those things that would be pleasing in His sight. And it's not about whether I have a cap on or whether I bow my head and close my eyes before I take some food in. But it is about things of the heart. And that's what God prepared beforehand that I should walk in. Verse 11, therefore remember that formerly you Gentiles in the flesh, which are called uncircumcised by the so-called circumcision, which is performed in the flesh by human hands. Verse 12, remember that you were at that time separate from Christ because of our ungodliness. We need to be saved. We need to repent, turn to God. Excluded from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. That's where we were. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were formerly far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. The blood of Jesus that was shed to cleanse us of sin and unrighteousness so that we can be made pure to have relationship with Holy God. But now in Christ you who formerly were far off have been brought near by His blood. Verse 14, for He Himself is our peace, who made both groups into one and broke down the barrier of the dividing wall by abolishing in His flesh the enmity, which is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, that in Himself He might make the two into one new man, thus establishing peace, and might reconcile them both in one body to God through the cross, by it having put to death the enmity between Jew and Gentile, between descendants of Israel and non, to break down that division, that barrier that Jonah had in his heart with that disdain and actual hatred toward the people of Nineveh. Nineveh's conduct was probably much like American cities today that need repentance, that need change. People's lives are destroyed and miserable, and they need Jesus Christ in their lives. Jesus said, I didn't come to condemn what they're doing. The Word is already condemning them. Their own conscience, if it's still alive, is condemning them. What they need is they need the opportunity to come to God. Look at verse 19. So then you're no longer strangers and aliens, but your fellow citizens with the saints, and you're of God's household, having been built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, the teaching of the Word here, Christ Jesus Himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole building, being fitted together, is growing into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also were being built together into a dwelling of God in the Spirit. Also, God is in the building business. Well, He is. You know what kind of building He's building. It's not sticks and stones and brick and mortar. It's a spiritual building. It's a spiritual household. It's a spiritual body. And He welcomes us who were aliens and strangers into becoming a part of that body so that we can have a relationship with God and show forth the goodness of God and the praise of God. Not that we would stand in self-righteousness and condemn other people who don't follow our fleshly circumcisions that we've been entrained with. Kurt was saying that the Greek word for edified is literally talking about someone who's building a house, uplifting. How about that? Building something up. And that's what we're doing, is we're building up a spiritual body with a connection You know, and it's amazing the way that God will work through us. And Kelly, I want to use you as an illustration, but Kelly brought a friend from Colorado to a Bible study about a month ago and came over to the church in Queen Valley. And last Sunday, her friend and her 21-year-old son got baptized at a church in Colorado because they were so excited about turning their lives to the Lord. And Kelly had a part in that. Isn't that awesome, Kelly? Isn't that amazing? It's wonderful. What God can do by a simple little invitation. Say, man, I'm getting some bread. I want to share that bread. And these people went home and they found a church to fellowship there and they demonstrated their faith in Christ. We are building up a spiritual body. God is doing that with us. But I want you to notice that in Ephesians, it doesn't say anything about what food you put in your mouth. It doesn't say anything about, you know, the length of your hair or what clothing that you're wearing or what kind of cap you have on. He's not talking about speaking a certain, you know, Christianese, you know, just speaking the language. You can know the part. Yeah, I went forward and I walked the aisle and I was washed in the blood and got baptized. You can learn all that language in your heart, not be anywhere near God. And that's where Paul writes and says the fruit coming from the person's life is going to manifest whether they met Jesus. Not by whether they take their cap off or put on a suit and tie and go to church. Or in some cases, throw off the suit and tie and go to church. You see, Ephesians 2 is talking about spiritual things, things of substance in our relationship with one another. Spiritual things that spring forth from the heart. Go to Romans chapter 2. We'll back up just a little bit. Romans chapter 2. In verse 1, it starts off with a really interesting statement as he's really kind of rebuking the believers in Rome. Because they'd slipped into a bunch of fleshly circumcision things. Listen to this. Romans 1. Therefore, you are without excuse, every man of you who passes judgment. For in that you judge another, you condemn yourself. For you who judge, practice the same things. Now, there's really a lot in this verse, and I wouldn't mind spending about 30 or 45 minutes just on this verse right here, but that's a subject for another time. Let me just suffice it to plant a thought there. And you can throw it in the pot. It's around here somewhere. Throw it in the keg over here and let it simmer a little bit. When we see someone else's conduct and this fleshly thing in us rises up in judgment and condemnation, and usually it spills out of our mouth against them. Is in the thing that you spew judgment and pass judgment on other people is the thing you're guilty of. I can just give you an illustration. Homosexuality has not been a problem in my life. When I encounter someone or I hear of someone that is walking in that lifestyle, nothing in me rises up to spew judgment and condemnation on them about that. My heart really goes out to them. Because something has been broken in their lives. And they're trying to find a way to satisfy that longing and that brokenness. And in many cases, you take it and you go right back to, you know, either the family you came from or maybe the parents. Not necessarily always the parents. If you're a parent here and your kids have gone to homosexual direction or something like that, I'm not passing judgment on you at all. I'm just saying that something was askew along the way. And I feel sad. I feel broken. Just like I feel for a woman that goes from man to man to man to man, trying to fill that emptiness for love that she didn't get from her father. It's not always that, but a lot of times that's what it is. And all the men in the world will never fill that emptiness, but Jesus Christ can. And that manly, godly kind of love that very few young men get anymore is missing. That's pushed a lot of young men into homosexuality. There's nothing in me that rises up in judgment and condemnation. My heart aches because I know Jesus can fill that longing. Physical relationships cannot fill. I know Jesus can do that. But things that I have had a problem with in the past, sometimes I see other people doing that and it rises up in me and it wants to come out and spew all kinds of judgment and condemnation. Many times, Romans 2:1 is kicking in here, and God's saying the reason it bugged you so much about that person is because you are guilty of the same thing. Now, that bothers you, throw it in the pot and let it simmer, but that's really what I see Paul saying. You're without excuse, every man of you who passes judgment. When you're not just that you're looking and saying, oh, that's not good, I don't want to go there, but you're passing judgment, like a judge or like a jury, passing judgment on someone's deed.
That's what I call looking in the mirror. It's hell looking in the mirror.
Looking in the mirror. Okay.
Yeah. So, and I see that with my guilt. Uh-huh. I mean, I need to see that. And I know it's because they're doing exactly what they told me.
Oftentimes, a son who has a personality and acts in a lot of ways like his dad, they butt heads worse than anybody. The two that are most alike. And that's part of the principle that's coming out right here. For in that you judge another, you're spewing judgment on or passing judgment. Not just that you're discerning, not just that you're seeing that something isn't good, you don't want to go that way, but that you want to spew judgment and condemnation on him. It's telling something about what's in you. One of my sons the other day said, you know, when he was telling me about a situation, he said, when that happens, he said, my blood just boils, and I always stop and say, God, where is that in me? Because I wouldn't be bothered this much about it if it wasn't in me. For he says, you're condemning yourself as you do that. For you who judge in this manner, passing judgment, or you do the same thing. And just because we look at something and recognize and identify that it's wrong, that's not saying that we're guilty of that. No, that's not what he's saying. But the spewing out and passing judgment and condemnation on other people, that's what he's talking about. And he says, we know the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice these things. And do you suppose, oh man, when you pass judgment upon those who practice such things and do the same yourself, that you'll escape the judgment of God? Or do you think lightly of the riches of his kindness, forbearing, and patience, not knowing the kindness of God leads you to repentance? But because of your stubbornness and unrepentant heart, you're storing up wrath for yourself in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. Listen to what Paul says. Who will render to every man according to his deeds. Isn't that interesting? Is this in the New Testament? Nod your head or wag your head. Yes, this is in the New Testament. He's quoting the Old Testament, but Paul's saying that's what's going to happen for all of us. To those, verse 7, who by perseverance in doing good are seeking for glory and honor and immortality, here's what they get: eternal life. For those that are persistent in that. But to those who are selfishly ambitious, do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, here's what they get: wrath and indignation. Verse 9, there will be tribulation and distress for every soul of man who does evil, of the Jew first and also the Greek. But what about the Jews that followed the rule of circumcision? No, that's exactly who he's talking about. There's not going to be some physical thing you can do to bribe God because God's looking at your heart. But glory and honor and peace, verse 10, to every man who does good, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For there's no partiality with God. He is looking at the deeds of our life that spring forth from our heart. And taking your cap off is not going to be a substitute for repenting and loving your neighbor. Praying every time before you eat a meal is not going to be a substitute for genuinely acknowledging that God is your provider and not being arrogant and proud about, look at all the stuff I've done for myself and my family. Verse 12, for all have sinned without the law will perish without the law, and those who have sinned under the law will be judged by the law. For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers. It's one of those things that the young pastor really began to trouble me. I began to see in my congregation while I was pastoring Mesa that nothing that we were studying and learning in the Scripture was changing people's conduct. And they really felt like, because they endured through one of my sermons, that now God owed them something. And you know, if we went past 12, and we always went past 12, they got credit toward next week. I can leave 20 minutes early. But you see, God's dealing with the substance of what's in our hearts. But I saw that a lot of these people really believed they were satisfying their obligation and relationship with God by coming and listening to the Bible being proclaimed. But it had no impact on their lives. One man used to shake my hand at the back of the church, and Lynn will remember this. We'd stand next to each other, come back, shake our hand on the way out. And he'd say, boy, preacher, you really told them today. He said that to me every week. Every week he said that to me. You remember him from music today? The little skinny guy. Yeah. Boy, preacher, you told them today. But you see, it isn't sitting and listening and hearing who are justified before God, but those who take action on what God shows them. So perfect attendance pins aren't going to mean anything to God on the judgment day. But God, 40 years, perfect attendance. You know, that's an admirable goal, but it's not a substitute for what God wants. The substance is about our conduct, our deeds, in our relationship with our fellow man. God's always been concerned about that. So not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers. In verse 14, he goes on and makes the point even stronger. When the Gentiles who don't have the law do instinctively the things of the law, these not having the law are a law to themselves. It's in their heart. In that they show the work of God written in their hearts. And God's given that to them, Kelly, like you're saying. The conscience. God has enabled and told them, this is wrong, this is right. Their conscience either bearing witness in their thoughts, alternately accusing or else defending them. On the day when, according to my gospel, God will judge the secrets of men through Christ Jesus. You see, the problem when we start getting into this fleshly circumcision is that we want to compare what we're doing. Look, I dress up on Sunday. I don't use any cuss words while I'm at church. I take my hat off when they pray. I always bow my head and close my eyes and make everybody stop and pray. I heard about one pastor, he was so big on that. He's in the restaurant and he stood up and he said, quiet everybody, we're going to ask God's blessings on this food. Even with a whole, you know, table of people that never had seen him before and everything. It's no wonder that, you know, the world is annoyed at Christian people. Because sometimes those kind of self-righteous things can really be obnoxious. By the way, on 9/11, when they said, let's pray, guess what? Everybody wanted to pray. See, there's an appropriate time to say, let's all pray. Columbine High School, the ACLU didn't sue anybody because they were praying while their classmates were being killed around them. Isn't that interesting? See, there is a right time to do that. But there's also a braggadocious self-righteousness that we can put on. That is the fleshly circumcision. God doesn't want us to get ourselves involved in because He wants the things that issue forth from our heart. Verse 17, if you bear the name Jew, rely upon the law, boast in God, knowing His will, prove the things that are essential. Verse 18, being instructed out of the law, you're confident that you're a guide to the blind, a light to those in darkness, a corrector of the foolish, a teacher of the immature, having in the law the embodiment of knowledge and of truth. You therefore who teach another, do you not teach yourself? You who preach one should not steal, do you steal? You who say one should not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? You who abhor idols, did you rob temples? You who boast in the law through your breaking the law, do you dishonor God? Listen, verse 24. For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you. And unfortunately, that is still very true today. We need to guard ourselves and our conduct and our relationships. We don't want to be the person that others are blaspheming God because of our deeds. If they are blaspheming God, let it be because of false accusations and lies. That does happen too. The name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you. And you say, what does this have to do with circumcision? This is the circumcision. Listen, verse 25. For indeed, circumcision is of value if you practice the law, but if you're a transgressor of the law, your circumcision has become uncircumcision. You see, the Hebrew people thought that if they followed faithfully and took off males that symbol of being Jewish, that gave them special standing with God. You see, there are people today that think the same thing about baptism. I got baptized. I know I'm going to heaven. In fact, maybe we'll have a chance here in a little bit to go to Colossians before we go home tonight, where Paul says that baptism and circumcision teach the same message. They're both the same thing. And if there were people back then that thought because they had been circumcised and they were following the physical rules and laws, that they have a special standing with God, it's just like today, people who think, I've taken the sacrament, I've taken communion, I've been baptized, I've been confirmed, therefore I have a special standing with God. What's your heart showing? By the way, there's nothing wrong with any of those things. There's instruction in Scripture about them, but they are not a substitute for the substance, and the substance is about the heart. And about you loving God and loving your neighbor from the heart. And so, he says, in verse 26, if the uncircumcised man keeps the requirements of the law, will not his uncircumcision be regarded as circumcision? In verse 27, will not he who is physically uncircumcised, if he keeps the law, will he not judge you? So having the letter of the law and circumcision are a transgressor. And then he says this in verse 28. Don't miss verse 28. For he is not a Jew who is one outwardly, neither is circumcision that which is outward in the flesh. And what is it? He is a Jew who is one inwardly, and circumcision is that which is of the heart, by the Spirit, not by the letter, and his praise is not from men, but from God. Do you get it? Are you seeing it? You see, it never was about the physical act of circumcision, just like it was never about the physical act of baptism. It was never about the physical experience of taking communion in the Lord's Supper. It was about the heart. Taking on Jesus is eating his flesh, is taking our life from him and drinking his blood. The life of Jesus, the life of the flesh is in the blood. It is taking the life of Jesus Christ in us so that we walk and talk and act and do conduct our relationships like Jesus. And if you're not doing that, you can take communion every day to the rest of your life and you'll not fulfill that commandment or that requirement from God. And if you do the physical one without the other, it's no better than physical circumcision or physical baptism. And there's no fruit from the heart. You see, the physical circumcision was a reminder that we have to die to our fleshly nature. Our fleshly nature wants to exalt itself. Our fleshly nature wants to pass judgment on other people. Our fleshly nature doesn't want to forgive. It wants to hold grudges. Our fleshly nature wants to be jealous. Those are the things to which our heart must die. We have to put them under our feet. They need to be circumcised. Our heart needs to be circumcised. And all of that thrown away so we can rejoice with the one who's being blessed and in benefits and rejoice with those who rejoice in him. We can weep with those who are weeping. Why? Because our heart has been baptized. And baptism, as much as it's a picture of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, that's good, but there's a deeper meaning, and the deeper meaning is if we're going to walk with God, we have to die to our selfish, sinful ways and let Jesus Christ be resurrected in us by taking the meaning of our hearts. That's the real baptism. It's of the heart. The real circumcision is of the heart. The real communion is of the heart. All of it is about the heart. God is in the heart business. And He's in the business of transforming hearts. And the terrible substitute is that we think it's taken our cap off when we go into church or somebody's praying or saying a prayer before we eat a meal. We offer all of these substitutes to God. And all the while, God wanted our hearts. He wants us to love Him with all our heart. Let's just jump for a moment over to Colossians 2. And I want us to have some time to pray for some folks tonight before we get away. Colossians chapter 2, that's General Electric Power Company. That's the C in that. This is an admonition here in Colossians. It's so pertinent for us today. Listen to what verse 6 says. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in Him. Isn't that interesting? As you receive Him, walk in Him. You see, a lot of religion expends its energy saying, you shoulda, coulda, woulda, had, oughta. And that's not the way God deals with us. God doesn't deal with us in theoretical terms or in Disneyland. He deals in the real world. And in the real world, most of us have made a mess of our lives in one fashion or one way or another. And we can't go back and undo a lot of the mistakes that we've made. Now, if we need to repent and ask forgiveness of people, we need to be ready to do that. If we need to make restitution, when I was pastor at the Baptist Church on North State in Mesa, we had a lot of vandalism problems at the building. That was kind of on the edge of town way back then. North State did it. A kid came one day and he said, I've turned to the Lord and I came. I need to make restitution. I used to come over to the church and break the lights, the floodlights on the outside of the church. And I said, that's all right, we forgive you. He said, no, I really need to pay. And he gave us $20 or something, which, you know, would buy back then. I probably bought 8 or 10 light bulbs or something, you know, so floodlights. So, you know, sometimes there are ways in which we need to make restitution. Some people we need to ask forgiveness from. But, you know, what about somebody who's gone through a bad marriage and you've had a divorce? I've actually heard people say, well, you've got to go back and remarry that person. There's no going back and undoing that. But I've actually, you know, heard some people who were biblical teachers and counselors, and that's what they said that is going to solve the problem. Boy, you talk about creating havoc and chaos. And so, in fact, if you go look at instruction in the law, it says that if you divorce someone and they remarry, even if their spouse dies, you can't go back and remarry. It's kind of interesting. You know? Again, what is the law but God giving some guidelines and some guardrails for us in life? So what he's saying here is, whatever circumstances you are in your life, don't start living in regret. Repent of the sin and repent of the unrighteousness. Repent of the mistakes that you've made. And God's going to take you from right where you are to the place of abundance in His kingdom.
Yes.
And to the place of Jesus being fully Lord in your life. That's what He's saying. In the state in which you are, as you've received Christ, walk in Him. Having been firmly rooted and now being built up in Him and established in your faith, just as you were instructed, and overflowing with gratitude. Gosh, our hearts should be filled with gratitude for all that God has done for us and all that Jesus did for us and all the provision and the fact that he welcomes us into his kingdom. I've never had someone come to me and say, hey, Rick, I'd like for you to be in business with me. And now that I have experience as a businessman, nobody's going to come to me and say, oh, wow, you've done so good. But God said to me, come and be a part of my kingdom. And then he says in verse 8, see to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deception according to the tradition of men, according to the elementary principles of the world rather than according to Christ. For in him all the fullness of deity dwells in bodily form. You want to know what God's like? Look at Jesus. You want to know what God looks like? Look at Jesus. You want to know how God would deal with the circumstance? Look at Jesus. Because in him, in bodily form, we have God here in this world. And he says in verse 10, and in him you've been made complete. And he's the head over all rule and authority. And in him you were also, here it is again, circumcised with the circumcision made without hands. Now, if you haven't gotten the picture yet, this has nothing to do with the physical circumcision. It has to do with spiritual things. Listen, Paul says you've been circumcised in a circumcision made without hands, not a physical circumcision, a spiritual one. Look, in the removal of the body of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. And that circumcision is where you cast off the flesh. The flesh says, get even. The flesh says, don't forgive. The flesh says, do unto others before they do to you. The flesh says the golden rule is he who has the gold rule. See, all of those things that we laugh about in American society that, isn't that a great twist? All of that's what we die to when we come to Jesus. And that's what circumcision is. It's about the heart. It's not about taking your cap off. But if you want to take your cap off, that's okay. It's not about bowing your head and closing your eyes and praying some memorized prayer before you eat food. But if you want to pray, if you're moved to do that, that's fine. That's all right. It's a wonderful thing if you teach your kids to be grateful. But you see, what God's dealing with is the substance. Teach your kids to forgive. Don't throw it in their face again. Don't just focus on these external kinds of things because the substance belongs to Christ. And that's what the real circumcision is. Is Paul coming along here and introducing some new doctrine? No. This is actually what the physical act of circumcision has always been illustrating. But they weren't getting it. They put their trust in the physical act of circumcision. And that's not where the substance is. So we were circumcised with the circumcision, verse 11, and without hands and the removal of the body of the flesh, by the circumcision of Christ. Now watch this. Having been buried with him in baptism. What? What does circumcision have to do with baptism? Everything. The message of both is identical. Because you notice this in the middle of the sentence. You were circumcised with the circumcision made without hands and the removal of the body of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, having been buried with him in baptism. In which you were raised up with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. He just told you that circumcision and baptism repeats the same thing. I can't tell you how many years I was a pastor and a teacher and baptized several hundred people through the years and never understood that the message of baptism is not only about the death, the burial, and resurrection of Jesus, but it's about your commitment to die to your fleshly nature if you're going to walk with God. We have to die to the old nature and be born all over again in the image of Jesus. That's what he's calling us to. Isn't that amazing?
Yes.
Right here in our Bibles. Where has that been all these years? Isn't that awesome? In verse 13, and when you were dead in your transgressions and the uncircumcision of your flesh, You were holding grudges, you were unforgiving, you were self-righteous, you were lustful, greedy, arrogant, jealous, all of that stuff. While you were doing all of that, he said he made you alive together with him, having forgiven us our transgressions, and having canceled out the certificate of debt consisting of decrees against us, which was hostile to us, he's taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. By the way, if you want to know what those decrees are, go back and read Deuteronomy 28. There are 14 verses that talk about the blessings and benefits that come on a person walking with God. But if you don't want to walk with God, okay, God gave you freedom of choice. Then the other 54 verses in Deuteronomy 28 talk about the curses that will come on you and your descendants in everything that you do. If you don't want to, but it's your choice. Okay. So, but see, he's canceled out the certificate of debt and decrees against us, hostile to us, nailing it to the cross. And in verse, because see, Jesus died on the cross, not for the sins of the world. Okay? Jesus didn't die on the cross for the sins of the world. Jesus shed his blood for the sins of the world. He died on the cross to cancel the decrees, the curses of the law that would come against us. That's why Jesus died on the cross, was to remove, to cancel out the decrees against us. He nailed it to the cross. And in verse 15, and when he disarmed the rulers and authorities, he made a public display of them, having triumphed over them through Jesus. Therefore, here's the conclusion. That's what we're getting to. I'm just going to read a few more verses here. Let no one act as your judge in regard to food, drink, respect to a festival, new moon, Sabbath day. Listen to verse 17. Things which are a mere shadow of what's to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. He's saying, therefore, stop the fleshly circumcision. Oh, it's Sunday, you can't go out to have dinner. The last time I got rebuked for that was a Mormon lady. You mean that you go out to restaurants on the Sabbath? And I looked at her and I said, Lord, do I get in this discussion with her? The first thing I told her is, Sunday is not the Sabbath. You missed it, lady. That happened yesterday. The seventh doesn't magically become the first. The Sabbath is from sundown Friday to sundown Saturday. The Sabbath is on Saturday. This is Sunday, the first day of the week. I'm going to go eat. And I'll pay the waitress a good tip. Do you realize? Do you realize this whole thing? This whole thing about groups of eight or more where they add the gratuity on there? Yeah. Do you know, that's what I call the church tax.
Yes, yes.
Because church groups go after church on Sunday morning or after church on Sunday evening, and they go and they stiff the waitress and the waiter and don't give them a tip. And that's why restaurants had to start charging a fee if there's a large group, because everybody walks away and says, I'm not responsible. Now, how does that show the love of Jesus to a waitress? Yeah. Yeah. To a waiter? How does that show the love of Jesus to the people that are serving you? And what it shows is greediness in the hearts of people that claim to be God's people. I want you to know, they may have circumcision of their flesh. They may put on their suit and tie. They may put on their holy robe. They may speak Christianese all day on Sunday, but they're not anywhere walking with Jesus, or they leave a good tip for the person who's laboring over them. And so, this is the circumcision. Don't let anyone judge you about food, drink, all this stuff. These are just shadows. In verse 18, let no one keep defrauding you of the prize by delighting in self-abasement, the worship of angels, taking his stands on visions he's seen, inflated without cause by his fleshly mind, and not holding fast to the head, Jesus, from whom the entire body, being supplied and held together by joints and ligaments, grows with the growth which is from God. If you've died with Christ to the elementary principles of the world, why is it, if you were living in the world, do you submit yourself to decrees such as, do not handle, do not touch, don't touch, which all refer to things destined to perish with the using, listen, in accordance with the commandments and teachings of men. Oh, you can't drink that. Oh, you'll be defiled. One of my friends who married a sweet Mormon wife, and he converted to Mormonism, and he quit smoking, and he quit drinking.
And he was chiding all the other employees, at these young men at the power plant where I was working one time, about, well, you guys got to quit your smoking and your drinking and everything. And and it was kind of funny because he used to bum cigarettes from other guys that had worked. But anyway. That's right. And he says, you guys should quit your drinking and your smoking. And he turns and he looks at me, and I was sitting over at my table, and I was reading or studying or something over the lunch half hour. And he says, isn't that right, Rick? And I looked at him and I said, well, actually, Paul, his name is Paul. I said, actually, Paul, Jesus said it's not what goes in the mouth that defiles a man, but it's what comes out of the mouth. And all these other guys are kind of, all right, Rick's on our side. All right. And he said, well, that may be true, but what goes in the mouth is really important too. You know, well, you know what he was? That was his fleshly circumcision. He's now joined a church that told him, you know, don't drink, don't smoke, don't do this, dress this way, go to this meeting, and learn to speak our language. He said, these are destined to perish with the using. Listen to these, verse 23. These are matters which have to be sure. Listen, the appearance of wisdom and self-made religion, self-abasement, severe treatment of the body, but they are of no value against the real enemy. They are of no value. Do not handle, do not touch, do not taste, celebrate this day, act this certain way, speak this. They do not touch the real problem, which is indulging the fleshly nature in what it wants. And the fleshly nature can move right into the churches and can get really good at telling you how to circumcise your flesh. Oh, gosh, once a week, you've got to fast. Yeah. Oh, once a month, you've got to go do X. Don't put this kind of thing over your lips. Don't put this in your mouth. Things which are destined to perish with the using. There are no value against the real enemy, which is arrogance and pride. Look at me. I'm so much more holy than these people. The same attitude that led Jonah into the mess that he got. Is it beginning to, is this beginning to make a little bit of sense?
Yes.
Maybe you don't see a real strong connection yet between circumcision and these external things. But when we begin to understand that man's imagination for coming up with rules and regulations to lord over people to circumcise their flesh, it knows no bounds. I mean, I think that one of the most absurd is saying that if you don't read a translation of the Bible that was written 400 years ago, that you're going to hell or whatever. I have to tell you that over at the Queen Valley Church recently, the church was giving away some of these American English translations and American Standard Bibles like we've given some away here. And away out the door, a guy who I had been warned, oh, he probably won't come to hear you preach because you don't preach from the King James. And I was explaining how the King James translation was a modern translation in its day. There are some things that completely miss the mark. And, you know, even in the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not kill. That's one of the worst translations ever into English of what that commandment in the scripture actually says. It says, thou shalt not murder. Huge difference. A lot of guys in the military have had guilt heaped on them because they've had to go out and kill people. David, a man after God's heart, had killed hundreds of people. Yes. Not with a personal vendetta, but in defense of the nation.
He started with
a lion. Yeah, that's right. He did. That's right. And that's an interesting story that we could go read because he talks about him being uncircumcised, which is interesting.
Twice.
Okay, thanks, Bob. We were talking about that earlier today. About the Goliath, this uncircumcised Philistine, who is he to taunt God's armies? And see, there was something he was saying there. Here's a guy that doesn't have a relationship with holy God. And so, you see, man keeps coming up with, if he can find some little niche to separate people from one another, it can be about the day you worship on. It can be about the translation of the Bible that you're reading from. It can be about the kinds of songs that you sing in the service. And I've had flyers put it on my door in Casa Grande, King James only. If you're going to come to this church, King James only.
Do they call themselves Separatists?
They don't, but that's really what they're doing. That's really what they're doing, yeah.
Church down the street.
Yeah. And I noticed that when they're meeting, they have about four cars there. So thousands of people on their doorstep. That's really going to help people. But you see, what they want to do is religious leaders through the years want to find some little niche, something a little different to distinguish them, to tell you you can't associate with those other people. See, God wants His people to work collectively together as a part of His body, and men are always trying to divide them off, because they don't want their sheep. And I've had people, pastors, use that terminology. I don't want my sheep eating that bread over there. Because they might get confused. And you know what that means? They might get some life in them, something that'll transform their lives, and I might not see them anymore.
Yes.
Wanting to control and lord it over God's people, and that's been going on for centuries.